Today, we are going to discuss a very important and interesting topic of Indian political thought, that is Dayanand Saraswati's basic feature of his political thought. You know, Dayanand Saraswati was a very famous religious and social reformer, the founder of Arya Samaj, and also a Hindu nationalist, or according to many, he was a revivalist nationalist. He believed in revivalism. But going by only revivalism, we cannot understand the importance, the proper importance of Swami Dayanand Saraswati. He was the first to raise the slogan of Sarajya, the issue of Sarajya, which was later taken by Tilak. He also wanted to make India a self-reliant nation. That is why, much before Gandhi and others, he talked of Swadeshi. And again, he wanted a society where in many aspects there would be equality between men and women. All these make Dayananda a very important political thinker of his time. And Dr. Radhakrishnan, the great philosopher, he has described Dayananda as one of the makers of modern India. Let us deal with the basic features of Dayananda Saraswati's political thought. You know, the first feature of Dayananda Saraswati is his idea of Sarajya or Saraj. Swami Dayananda, as I have already told you, that he has first coined the idea of Swaraja. But this Swaraj was not to be confused with Indian autonomy as advocated by the supporters of the Home Rule movement or by Tilak. It was a Vedic Swaraj. He did not want to compromise the idea of Swaraj with autonomy. He wanted full independence, an independent state of India based on Vedic principles. So Vedic Swaraj was his kind of Swaraj. And so his kind of Swaraj, his idea of Swaraj was a far step ahead of the prevalent idea of Swaraj as propagated by the Home Rule movement supporters. The second is his emphasis on the relationship between religion and politics. Dayananda did not believe in the secular kind of politics. Rather, he thought that religion should guide politics. Because by religion, he did not have any faith, you know, in superstitions, idolatry. He believed that religion, truly speaking, religion should be the storehouse of ethics and knowledge. So, if we have to build up a good Swaraj, based on Vedic principles, this Swaraj should be guided by the religion. Religion as knowledge, religion as ethics. Dayananda's emphasis on the close relationship between religion and ethics was shared by many stalwarts of his time and afterwards, like Dadabhai Nauroji, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, or Mahadev Govind Ranade. All of them shared this idea that there should be a close relationship between religion and politics. Thirdly, he had faith in enlightened monarchy. He believed in monarchy. Let it be clear, monarchy for him was the best kind of government, but that monarch should be an enlightened monarch whose main goal was to achieve prosperity of his citizens, of his people. So prosperity and well-being of his people and dispensation of justice, administration by justice, administration of justice should be the basic goal of an enlightened king, enlightened monarch, not only self-fulfillment. So monarch, according to him, and I quote from Dayananda, the king should be such a person who would be accepted by the society as a worthy and superior being. And such a king, such a person who would be who would become a king, should be selected by the assembly of wise men of a state. So there would be monarchy, but this monarchy would be based on selective monarchy. Some persons, an assembly of wise men who can think about the welfare of the state, about the good of the society, these persons should assemble together and choose a king who has all the qualities, who is worthy of ruling without being self-seeking person, without being a self-seeking man. Fourthly, he had immense faith in Swadeshi. Because Dayananda, you know, as I have already mentioned, Dayananda wanted to build this nation, Indian nation, on a very strong foundation. So for that, self-reliance, especially on economic reasons, we should be dependent on ourselves. There should be self-reliance. And so Dayananda, much before Gandhi or the Swadeshi advocates during the anti-partition movement of Bengal, the advocates of these movements, they also advocated Swadeshi. But much before them, Dayananda also advocated Swadeshi for self-reliance. Fifthly, he had faith in democracy. But this democracy should not be confused with the democracy of the West. That is the rule of the majority. That is the quantitative democracy. He did not believe in quantitative democracy or the majoritarian democracy. He believed in the qualitative democracy. And according to him, Vedas also, Vedas and Manusmriti, they also prescribe such a kind of democracy. According to Rig Veda, a body of the people must elect the most learned men as the members of the educational assembly, most devout men as the members of religious assembly, and the most praiseworthy character as the members of legislative assembly. And from the members of the legislative assembly, that great man possessing all the excellent qualities be made the head or the ruler of the state. Thus, according to Dayananda and according to the Vedic references that he has made, what he wanted was a qualitative kind of democracy, not a simple majoritarian kind of or quantitative kind of democracy. Sixthly, he has immense concern for education. So education, he did not see education only as something which is a social necessity. According to him, it was also a political necessity. Because education builds character. Education make good citizens. So emphasis should be given on education. And here, he should be bracketed with Swami Vivekananda, who also immensely emphasized the importance of education. Education, according to him, should be free, at least at the primary level. It should be free. It is the duty of the state to arrange for a free education and for all at the primary level. For the men, women belonging to all castes and creed and class. Seventhly, decentralization of authority. You know, friends, we have already discussed that Dayananda wanted enlightened monarchy, but he didn't want a tyranny, a tyrant. He didn't want that all powers of the state should be concentrated in the hands of the monarch. Rather, what he wanted in modern parlance, we can say, a decentralization of power. Decentralization of power from the units of village communities. According to him, real power should come from below, that is, from village communities. Therefore, what he wanted, that the village communities should be strengthened in order to make the Vedic Swaraj a success. And in this way, he was a forerunner of the idea of decentralization of power, or the Gram Swaraj or village Swaraj, as later propounded by Mahatma Gandhi. The next point is the function of the state. Dayananda, who really believed that the Vedic Swaraj will be an ideal state, so he couldn't just designate the state to act on only on the matters of, maintenance of law and order, collecting taxes, or the defense matters. What he wanted, that the state should go beyond that. The state should really look after the well-being of the of its citizens, well-being of its citizens, prosperity of its citizens. And by prosperity, it didn't mean only material prosperity, but the moral uplift. Morally, ethically, they should be enriched. The citizens should be enriched. So that was his another goal, another characteristic of Dayananda's political thought. The functions of the state should go beyond the level of law and order maintenance. Ninth is a question of ahimsa or non-violence. Dayananda always supported non-violence because he knew that an action of violence will invite the same amount of counter-violence. So to avoid that, he wanted that ahimsa, the principle of ahimsa or non-violence, should be followed. Gandhi also, ahimsa is the key word of Gandhian principles, Gandhian politics. But according to Gandhi, non-violence or ahimsa is an absolute principle. You can always never compromise with this principle. But for Dayananda, it was not an absolute principle. Rather, it was a relatively important principle which should be followed. But if necessary, if the state feels it is necessary, state can apply a small amount of power when it is absolutely necessary. Or he did not refute the application of violence altogether like Gandhi. The 10th point is the characteristic of government authority, the kind of authority that Dayananda stood for. According to Dayananda, the state and society should be controlled by three assemblies or sabhas. They are Rajya Sabha, Dharma Sabha, and Vidya Sabha. Now, Rajya Sabha is to act as a legislature and a supervisor of the state. It should legislate, it should enact laws for the state, and it should see that the state is running properly, functioning properly, implementing all the policies properly. And it shall be composed of men of high qualities and character, and the members shall be responsible for making laws and see that these are implemented rightly without any fear or favor. Next comes Dharma Sabha. Dharma Sabha shall be an assembly of the most pious and religious persons who renounce the material luxury for the spiritual and understand the meaning and application of dharma. So Dayananda wanted the state and politics should be guided by the principles of dharma or dharma shastra. And this dharma sabha, the members of the dharma sabha are to look into whether these practitioners of politics and administration, they are following dharma niti or not. Thirdly, he talked about vidya sabha. This assembly shall be composed of most learned persons, according to Dayananda. It shall spearhead the spread of education and see that no citizen is deprived of education in terms of caste, gender and wealth. So education is the primary right, according to Dayananda, of all the citizens, irrespective of caste, class and sex. And this education, the spreading of education, this is the establishment of educational institution is the duty of the state, and Vidya Sabha will supervise this function of the state, and it will be composed by most educated, learned persons of the time. The last point of the last characteristics of Dayananda's political thought was the concept of was the notion of the Chakraborty ruler. In Satyartha Prakash and other writings, Dayananda speaks of a Chakraborty king for India. Literally speaking, the Chakraborty ruler means a king of kings or an emperor. But did Dayananda propound an idea of an Hindu empire or a Vedic empire? Not exactly. What Dayananda wanted, that a king should be there who will look after the spread of the message of universal brotherhood as propounded in the Vedas. So the Chakraborty ruler or the Chakraborty king is not a political king, but he is in charge of the duty of spreading the message of universal brotherhood through nobility of men or Aryas. And here comes the significance of his slogan, Krinnanto Bissam Aryam. Last point of our discussion, that an assessment should be made of Dayananda's political thought. It is without doubt that Dayananda has influenced a large number of Indian political thinkers of later generations. Lokmanya Tilak and some others, even Gandhi, were much influenced by his ideas. But at the same time, he was dubbed by many, and perhaps there are enough reasons for that, that he was basically a Hindu revivalist thinker. Of course, when he sought to go back to the Vedas, when he prescribed for going back to Vedas, when he promoted the idea of protection of cows and all the values that was held high in ancient Hindu society, he can be called a revivalist nationalist, of course. But there are reasons. He had to go through the conditions, which can be also discussed, why he had overemphasized the importance of Vedas. This should also be pointed out. And some of these conditions are like this. During his time, the host of learned and unlearned Brahmins, they justified the caste system based on superstitions and inert customs. In the name of customs, in the name of superstitions, they justified caste system. So that was a condition around him. The forces of Christianity, backed by the state patronage, was also there during his time. Christianity was being backed by the state, the missionaries' activities. The spread of modern scientific education also challenged Hindu religion and society in a very effective manner, in a very serious manner. And also pessimism and fatalism and lack of moral vigor in Hindu society, owing to its decline for centuries, was seen in the society around him, around his time. So these were the situation, these were the conditions through which he had to go, he had to work. Therefore, Dayananda tried to overcome these hurdles. Perhaps for this, he overemphasized the Vedic principles even in a modern world. And to boost up the morale of a pessimistic society, he tried to charge them up with forgotten values of ancient age, glory and wisdom. This explains to a great extent the context and reason for his revivalism.